Go, Jesse.
Welcome once again to the second installment of In Their Own Words Live. Last night we had Bob Peters, and we also had Tony Powell from Detroit, and also Houston, but actually he was in New York and all over the place. Tonight, we actually have from the land down under, none other than J.B. McCauley. Switched On Sound, Bondi Radio, you name it. This man is all over the place. He was in Chicago a few years. We met him in person, and he's been loving us ever since. So it was time for me to show him some love. Also, we have Charlie Anzalone, all the way from Buffalo, New York, by way of Las Vegas now. And he has a great story to tell as well. My lovely co-host is Jade, and she'll be taking over and whipping me into shape tonight. So this should be fun.
All right, guys. So first of all, you're here because of amazing stories to tell about your relationship with House. So we'll start with Charlie, but go ahead and both of you give me just a synopsis of your relationship with House and a little bit about your careers.
I started DJing full-time in 1975, playing a lot of funk and soul and European house music, a lot of the early garage music, after sitting in with DJs for a couple of years. And I was like the beginning, the real peak of the beginning of the disco era. All the independent labels were coming out with really great music. Salso Records, of course, you know, First Choice, Lolita Holloway, and, you know, Randy Muller, all his productions like Sky and Aura and all those groups. And there was just, it was really new, and radio wasn't playing it. And I had radio DJs coming to my clubs, checking out the music. People were packing the dance floors too. And as the years went by, it started to cross over on the top 40 radio. If you look at the radio charts, 75, 76, 77, half of the Billboard 100 were disco records, you know, that were crossover R&B songs. And I was lucky enough to be working at all the top clubs and knowing when to make my move into the next hot club. And, you know, I was on priority mailing lists from all the major record labels. I was a member of the IDRC record pool in New York City in 1977. And in 1979, I co-founded the Buffalo DJ Association record pool. And Buffalo was a small city. It was considered a secondary market, but we had a powerful radio station called WBLK. That Georgetown dog, Lorenz, famous DJ from the 50s, had started, and his son was running it. And there was a girl there who had a radio hot sheet called, On the Record. And her name was Vicky Turntable. And I would report to her and tell her what was happening in the clubs in the Buffalo area. She was so well-respected, record company executives would call her on Friday and ask her if they were going to have a job on a Monday. That's how tuned in she was. And being in Buffalo, we were on the Canadian border, and we had thousands of people, kids coming down from Canada to Buffalo to dance in the clubs, because our clubs opened up or closed at 4 a.m. We're in Canada. They stopped serving liquor at 1. So they would party in Hamilton and Toronto until midnight, come down to Buffalo and spend the last 2 hours dancing in our clubs. And I was fortunate enough to have a lot of New York City kids in my clubs, because the University of Buffalo was all kids from Brooklyn, Bronx, Queens, Long Island. And they were really, really hip to a lot of the new stuff, you know, that wasn't on radio. It was just strictly club music. And towards the late 70s, into the early 90s, there were a couple of guys playing house music in a warehouse club, a little underground scene. And they used to hang out at a record store I hung out with called Apollo Records. And that's where I got hooked into, in the 80s, to all the DJ International stuff that Rocky Jones put out. And, you know, all the Jesse Saunders, the Farleys, the Jack Master, Fuck Off Fingers, one of my favorite, Mystery of Love. And I started interjecting that into my clubs in the 80s. And but little did I know that the music I was playing in the 70s was going to be the basis for house music. You know, tracks like Let No Man Put Us Under and all these songs that were sampled in the 80s that came out of the 70s. You know, they were sampled for all the cool house records. And then in all the Euro dance music into the 90s, all that 70s disco stuff was sampled, and it is till this day.
Awesome. And Jay, let's hear a little bit about you.
Well, I'm a product of London, and I grew up in the suburbs. And when we were growing up, we were generally listening to pop music, you know, like the Standard Affair coming through the 80s. And then in 1989, the whole culture in the UK changed with the Summer of Love and house music coming into the landscape then, and it completely changed how Europeans and especially people in the UK spent their Friday, Saturday nights, their weekends, and instead of just going from clubs and pubs, which were very sedate affairs, they were going to these hedonistic festivals and raves where the music just consumed you, and it was different and it was subversive and it felt revolutionary, and it inspired a whole generation of especially people in the UK to get out and enjoy themselves in unbridled passion for the music. So in 1989, that music started coming around, but for me, but that was very rave focused. And when I was growing up, so I was born in the 60s, when I was growing up, one of my friends had introduced me at an early age to stuff like Motown, Muscle Shoals, Stax, and things like that. So I've always been into the musicality of dance music, which is what Soulful House and what the house music that I love today has come about from. So I started getting involved in just being a normal consumer of that stuff back in the late 80s and the early 90s. And then I moved overseas to the European mainland and started DJing properly. And I remember the track that did it for me, that really changed me from doing the techno rave sort of scene, was JD and Plastic Dreams. And I was just amazed by that track because it was so different. It explored new landscapes and new genres and was just different from that very heavy techno rave scene that I'd come from. And from that moment on, I've been writing about music. I've been a journalist for many magazines writing about house music, and I've been singularly dedicated to DJing, performing both here in Australia and sometimes overseas, playing music that I love that touches me. And I think the music that came from Chicago that spread to the world is one of the greatest gifts Chicago's ever given people. So, I just get amazed by the constant outstanding work that comes from the house music community. And these times when we're all suffering a little bit, I think that house music really does bring people together in a way that few other forms of music can.
It does. In all of the stories, there is that general theme of community that comes along with house. It brings all kinds of people together, no matter where you are. And especially for you, Jay, I mean, you started in London and were able to build a bridge to the States with the New York, Chicago house scene. What was that like for you?
It's just so rewarding. Like, and interviewing people for our magazine, like Special Music, and seeing people's real passion or the music they love is something that we like to share. It's not just people talking about a song, or they're not talking about a product. They're talking about a whole sense of being and how it affects them emotionally. And they, and as in Jesse's book, in their own words, you can see this at every step along the equation. But people aren't just interacting with a song. They're interacting with a feeling, and they're able to express those feelings. And so talking to people in New York, like Lenny Montana and David Morales, Jesse himself, we've been speaking to The Chosen Few, Ron Carroll, Barbara Tucker, all these different people have one thing in common, and it's an absolute love for what they do and for house music. And to hear those words and be able to write those words and put them down on a website for people to read is all the reward I need.
Hey, Jay, let me ask you, how did you end up in Chicago those few years ago to even start all this?
I did a really big journalistic piece called House Has a Home on the history of house music in Chicago, and also incorporating yourself, Wayne Allen, and all the stories from Chosen Few, also DJ Pierre, and amongst others. I can't remember all the names I did, but that was a massive piece of work. It was like 3 months worth of work to get that down as an article. And because I'd written that article, I had to say to the wife, we're going to the States, we're going to the Chosen Few, we're going to spend some time in Chicago, because for us, coming from London and hearing all that music originally, and then having all of this interaction between all my friends overseas who still DJ and still amongst it, it was imperative to me to go to Chicago and see where it all began. So that's why we ended up there. And it was besides my marriage and my children, it's one of the greatest moments of my life.
Awesome. Now, question for you, Charlie. House music has always been described as underground sound, or in some places, you know, it's kind of illegal or elusive. How much do you think that played a part in how quickly it grew? The fact that it was kind of this underground, forbidden thing at the start.
Well, in the 70s, early 70s, you had the Stonewall riots in New York City. Because the laws were at that time, men couldn't dance with men and women couldn't dance with women. So a lot of clubs opened up, like Nicky Siano's gallery. David Mancuso had his parties at the Loft, where people would go to these places and all dance together and feel good together. And they were playing a lot of underground music. Like I said, that wasn't played in a lot of mainstream clubs, and it wasn't played on radio. And then when the Vietnam War ended, people needed something to feel good about again. And that's when the disco movement really exploded. Blacks, whites, straights, and gays, and everybody went to the discos and danced together. And it wasn't like, it was like house music is, where no matter what religion, race, creed, color, you all got together to feel good again. And that's what made the 70s going into and really exciting. And that led into the feeling that house music gave the people in the 80s in Buffalo, especially at the smaller venues. And then there was always like 2-3 big giant events a year. And that's what DJs got together to play house and everything that they couldn't play in their top 40 clubs. And it was just enjoyed by everybody because it was like all so new and different. And then a good friend of mine, I think Jay will know, John Aquaviva, him and Richie Haughton started a label in like 1989 called Plus 8 Records, and he came out with a record called Technarchy by Cybersonic. You remember that, Jay? That was a huge, huge record in Manchester clubs.
Yeah, man, I remember that.
He brought that copy to, he brought it to a mushroom club in Manchester and sold like thousands of copies like the next DJ played it there. House music relates a lot to disco, where it has a feeling, a theme where people just all want to be together and be happy. And, it sort of broke away from a lot of the heavy racism in the 60s. I'm 67 years old, so I was a teenager when a lot of that shit went on. And but then when disco started, really in the early 70s, long before Saturday Night Fever, bars started to replace bands with guys playing records, little 45s. And people started to crawl out of the racism and segregation thing and start all going to the clubs together. And I saw that at a lot of clubs. In the mid-70s, after we'd get out of the discos, when the discos closed, we would go to a place called the Speakeasy, which was on the east side of Buffalo. And it was in a all-black section of the town, but all the whites went there for the good food and the good music. And we'd go there until 5-6 o'clock in the morning. And we would all, everybody, no matter what color you are, what age you were, a lot of underage people, all went there and partied to all kinds of cool underground soul music till the sun came up. So, house music is an extension of disco, and it just makes people feel really good. And hopefully it'll make them forget all their troubles in the times that we're in.
For sure. And definitely since you, you know, you referenced that with everything going on in our country today, question for both of you guys. Jay, I'll have you answer it first. But just where do you see house fitting in, and how important is it now that people remember what house is really about and that unifying factor?
Are you asking
was
me?
That a question for me?
Or was that Jay?
I'm going to ask, but Jay, I'll have you answer first.
Okay.
So what does house music mean today as the unifying factor? I'm hoping that message of love and unity is able to get through to those sectors in society in America where it's truly needed. I think when it came through to the fore in the UK, it was a movement, and that was the same for Australia as well. It was a movement that like I said, broke down all the social barriers. We didn't have I wasn't around for the same effect of disco in the 70s. I was only a young man then, but and the effect on the gay scene. But I do know that it's completely deconstructed prejudices that we had in the in society through the inclusion of house music, especially that rave culture and that unity. And I'm hoping that we can elevate that once more to the rest of society, because we need it in these troubled times. I think the music has always been about love, beats and peace. I don't think it's ever needed to have any propaganda behind it to spread that. It's pretty evident from the word go. I do know that, like, from the clubs we had in London, which was Shoom, The Wag, Ministry and things like that, they were all inclusive. And that was very new for the UK, because it was fairly segregated in terms of its sexuality and things like that. So just getting to meet people from different cultures and different backgrounds was something that expanded the minds of most people in the UK. And that was the same here for in Australia as well as it progressed here. So hopefully we can keep those things at the forefront of our mind when we're thinking about all the troubles that we're going through at the moment.
All right, Charlie, same question for you. Just where do you see house fitting in, and what's important that we're reminded right now during this time?
I hope that when clubs start opening up again, because of course right now, you know, with the COVID-19 thing, social distancing, the clubs, the casinos are opening in Las Vegas, but the clubs aren't right now. But and I think that Coachella's been postponed or canceled, the EDM, a lot of the big festivals. And I hope when they come back, that the house electronic music makes people feel good again. And I hope it makes people forget about protesting, politics and everything. And I'd hate to see a big festival and then see people waving signs and all this crap. Just dance and enjoy yourself and have a good time for that 24, 48 hours that you're at a festival.
Yeah, I did an interview yesterday on WVON in Chicago, and we had a guy call in and said something to the effect is, with all this stuff going on out there, how can you all be talking about music? And that kind of, it struck me like, music is the only thing that will really get us through all of this. You know, music exactly. Is the savage beast. You know, it's like, why do you want your life consumed 24 hours a day with basic destruction and, you know, negative stuff? And I mean, protesting is great. We should do it. It's all right. And there's definitely a great reason to do it right now. We should all be behind that. But at some point, you need to hoo-sah and calm down and relax a bit and take stock of where you are and what's going to move us forward, as opposed to what's going on right in this moment that's making you feel bad. So I think, like I said, music soothes the savage beast. So even if you're angry, it gives you that moment to take a breath and relax. Because we all know stress is a killer. You know, doesn't have to be a cop or anybody else. You can do it to yourself by stressing yourself out. So everyone needs to at least take a breath and take stock of what's going on. So I think that we definitely need the music.
I couldn't agree more. I personally think that with the 24-hour news cycle, that we're just generating so much stress and anxiety for ourselves by repeatedly consuming images that are damaging to your well-being and everything like that. Music gives you the opportunity to detach from the world for a moment, for a second, to reset yourself and refocus on things that are equally as important, which is your own well-being.
Oh, yes. Well-being is definitely important.
But it's okay to take some personal mental...
I turn off the TV every now and then and turn my turntables on.
Right? There you go.
Yeah. And I kind of want to get... Since we're speaking of music, let's kind of get into the nitty-gritty of it. We've mentioned disco and house being an extension of it, but you've played all kinds of styles during your career and the story in Jesse's book. What's your favorite and why?
Talking to me, right?
Yes.
Okay. I like the late 70s Euro disco, you know, when I started to get electronic with Giorgio and producers like Alec Casandinos and Don Ray and that whole stuff that came out of Europe. And I like the early mid 80s stuff with the Chicago sound and with the stuff that came out on Prelude Records, a lot of his soulful dance music, like Love's Holiday by the group James that Ray Caviano put together for his label RFC Records. And a lot of the early house music I was getting from Apollo Records, you know, all the Chicago records I mentioned before, you know, Farley Fingers, Jesse, and the Kevin Saunderson stuff that came out, Detroit, and there was just that was a real good song because it was soulful. It was almost like disco with an updated track to it, and that's. That was my favorite. I just love the thumping, soulful, funky house sound.
And how about you, Jay? You've got experience in a couple different genres of house.
So mine is very much like Charles. I like the funky stuff of dance music from James Brown and that real Philadelphia soul stuff as well. But if I was to be honest, it was that early 90s house music where house music was more of a, it progressed to becoming more song-based rather than track-based, which it seems to have gone full circle again now because now the music is very much like a track instead of a song. We have snippets of vocals rather than the whole landscape of a song. But in those early 90s with Barbara Tucker, you know, music like that where the vocals were at the forefront of the music, I really, really loved that. And if you're standing in a room and you're belting out the words and you're singing the words alongside a total stranger, there's nothing happier than that. It's a sense of community. Everybody's enjoying that one moment and singing along to a song. I think when we take a lot of the
hands
song
in the air.
Out of the track. Yeah, exactly right, man. Exactly right, man. Woo-wee! And I think when you've got that sense of community by singing along to something, and everybody knows the words, and everybody can celebrate that moment. I think in a house song, I think that's what really, really does make it. So I'm hoping that we're going to go another circle again and go back to that full song sort of valuation that we get with house music, and I think it's coming back. So I've been praying for that for like 3 years.
Yeah, especially the soulful female vocals like Princess and Heat of the Passion Moment and all that. There was just so many good songs, like you said, not just thumping tracks for people who were like out of their minds would dance to, but songs that you can hear and sing along to that had a hook. They told a story, it had a beginning, a middle, and an end, like the old disco tracks did. And
Charlie,
a soulful house track. Yeah.
Right. No, I just wanted to ask you real quick. The first chapter of the book, I actually went and did a whole bunch of research. I don't think I researched anything like that since I was in college. But I wanted this chapter because all throughout this time, the years, the documentaries and everything, no one has defined where disco started. We know where house music came in, but where actually did disco start? So I want to ask you, when did you know that a song was disco? What was the first record, or what was the first time that you knew something was disco?
When I turned 18 years old, it was 1971. There was a big disco called Uncle Sam's, which was a chain of discotheques across the country that played, you know, rock, pop, soul, and everything. They had a drummer playing along to the records. And there was another little discotheque that opened called Fridays and Saturdays. these guys had worked in a rock club, and they had gone to New York and went to some bars, and DJs were playing soul records, fucking soul records. And so I would go into these clubs in the early 1971, 72, and the DJs were just playing 45s. There were no 12-inch records at the time. And they were playing all the top funky dance tunes that were played on the black radio station at home, WBLK and WUFO, which is where Frankie Crocker got his start, by the way. And it was in the early 70s. When I would hear these funky soul James Brown tracks, around 73, 74 is when it really kicked in, when I heard Georgia McRae, Rock Your Baby, and Rock the Boat by the Hughes Corporation. These were songs that were for the dance floor. You know, they were just produced and mixed for the dance floor. But like I said, 1971, I was going to in the clubs where DJs were playing records. They weren't so much Uncle Sam's and Friday Saturdays were the discotheques of the time, but the other places were like really cool bars where people hung out and they just played funk and soul 45s that people would just be grooving to. Disco came out of the word discotheque. A discotheque is an establishment that has a collection of recorded music instead of live bands. I mean, even back in the late 60s, the guy who brought disco to Buffalo, Marty Angelo, used to put bands at Sean Paul's The Scene in New York City. The Scene, everybody played there, Hendrix played there, Jim Morrison played there, but they had a DJ playing records between the bands. And that's when he came back to Buffalo in 1969 to put the first sound system in a bar. And it just evolved from there, from the early discotheques of 70, 71, and then 73, 74, a couple more discos opened, but they were playing records that were strictly for dancing. They weren't records that you wanted to just sit back and listen to. They had a groove, they had a melody, they had a beat.
What did you think of Funky Soul Mikasa? Did you think that was a disco record?
Funky Soul Mikasa, to me, set the bar for modern disco records, and Georgia McRae's Rock Your Baby raised it to a whole new level. Okay. Absolutely.
All right.
And it's actually funny we're talking about. Really, one of my favorite things about reading your story was that the first time you ever picked up the mic or did anything DJ related, you choked. So,
I choked. I used to go to this bar called Broner's, and I would hang out at the door, wait for the DJs to come and bring the records, and I'd help them carry their little 45s, a couple albums, you know. And I used to hang out next to sound booth. I was a groupie. This is like 1973. And so I was hanging out. This bar, it was three splits of Rolling Rock for $1 on a Wednesday night. It was oldies night. They played 50s, 60s, funk and soul and pop and rock records. So the DJs thought they'd say, hey, Charlie, you wanna put on a record? It's like, oh, hell yeah, sure. You know, I didn't know what I was doing. Only had one turntable, so he had to put the record on and say something on the mic while you put the other record on and put the needle on it. And so I went in there, the DJ went to take a break, and the first record, it was Help Me Rhonda by the Beach Boys, and I put it on, and he had a little piece of paper of things that you're supposed to, you know, the beer specials, this and that, and all. So I thought, here, I'm going to be a DJ. I turned on the mic, and I just, like, froze. I just dropped that needle on a record. I was so embarrassed. And years later, Buddy Ralph and Tommy shared the two GGs. They go, we created a monster. They sure did.
I was going to say, fast forward to 75, were you accepted and officially became a DJ? Was there ever an inclination in your mind of like, I didn't even want to do this, and now I'm here?
Yeah, I never expected it. I went to this bar called Melanie's that had, there was a couple, you know, of course, I used to go to the local discotheques that were booming at the time, and a new bar called Melanie's opened up. And my friend had built a sound system, and he was in there playing records. And, oh, it had two turntables and a little mixer. So he goes, you want to play some records? Sure. He took a break. I was playing records. He could just announce the specials. So I got on the mic and announced the specials. The club owner came up and said, are you my DJ? I said, no. Did you want a job? I said, yeah. So I got I got $35 tonight, all the booze I could drink and all the chicks I could meet, I guess. And that's what it started. It's, you know, when you're like 24 years old, what else would you want to do?
Right.
How about you, Jay? Was there ever a moment in your career where you were like, huh, this I can't do anything else. This is really where I want to be.
Like playing music is a privilege, right? So you're taking people on a journey. Sorry to sound all ethereal about it, but it's about living, like I said before, it's about living in the moment. And I remember, like Charlie, my first opportunity got when one of the DJs who worked at the club went on holiday, and I was originally doing security, and I went, you know what? I can give this a lash. And I did, and I've never looked back. And there's nothing more rewarding when you're playing music and you're blending music and you're building to something, and then the crowd just responds, like they go off. We use the phrase in Australia, they go off like a frog in a sock. They just go mad, you know. And that happened quite a few times in Portugal. It was the holiday resort as well, so we had a residency there. It was just packed with 300 to 400 people every single night of the week. And every single night of the week, people would go mad. So it was like, it was a drug in itself. It was addictive. And when you get that reaction from people, when people just are responding so well to everything you touch on the turntable, you can't help but fall in love with the profession, you know. And it's hard to find those pockets of acceptance these days, especially with the way the coronavirus is, with everything shut down. But the scene in Australia is not as big as it is in Europe. So you have to find your moments, you have to find your places, and you have to build a crowd. And it's particularly difficult in New South Wales and the state I live in, which really did quite punish the nightclub industry for many, many years because of incidents that we had within our nightclub districts. But that was slowly coming back, and then we had the coronavirus. So everything's on hold, like with everybody else, but we're hoping when it comes back, it's going to come back bigger and better than ever, and we'll be able to do those sorts of things. Yeah, but that first experience, I was the same as Charlie. Like, the bloke went on holiday, owner went, get behind the decks, have a go, and I'm like, oh, I don't know if I'm going to be any good at this. But the positives outweighed the negatives, and I've never looked back since.
And look at you now.
Exactly. We're live from the land down under with JB McCauley and Charlie Anzalone over there by way of Buffalo, New York, now living in Vegas. What's the temperature today, Charlie?
About 103.
It's high.
100, I think it's going down to 100. It was like 107 yesterday.
Yeah, but guess what? It's supposed to be on Sunday. Did you see it?
Yeah.
84 degrees. Can you believe it?
Drop it right down.
Yeah. Before it shoots right back up. But we're talking about my book, In Their Own Words, which was released yesterday, June 4th.
Jessica, I'll be right back. 1 minute.
Okay, don't leave us for too long.
Oh, no.
Bathroom break for Charlie. We're talking about my book, In Their Own Words, with featured stories by Jay and Charlie. And JB actually has a distinction of giving me a lot of inspiration to actually make this book in a form that actually would read as a book, because originally it would have been just a bunch of stories and I had no idea how I was going to put them all together. I actually had about 300 stories and 83 ended up making the book, not because the other 200 and something weren't any good, but because I finally was able to put together a narrative through chapters and start from the beginning and go all the way up until today, so that people can share their stories no matter when they join. Because, you know, when you think of something like this, usually you're talking about the people who were there in the beginning. Okay, that's great. But house music has been discovered along the way ever since. I mean, I have people that come up to me and say they just discovered it last year, but they love it just as much as we do. So their stories are important as well.
Yeah.
Well, and Jesse, how do you feel about... Well, of course, you know, with the technology age, of course, we were old school playing turntables and the CDs and all that stuff. And then John Apaviva and Richie Houghton co-founded Serato and changed everybody's DJ life. Yeah.
They founded Final Scratch, not Serato.
Yeah, well, Final Scratch. That's right, Final Scratch.
Oh, totally different.
And Beatport, too, I think, isn't it? Or they're involved in Beatport, too, I think.
Say that once more.
How do you feel about DJs doing these featured DJs, which a lot of them do, they play a pre-recorded set, turn the bass on and off, jump up and down, instead of really using their serrato to go from song to song to song, because I see it all the time.
Well, I think these days for that electronic dance music crowd, those big, ridiculous festivals with hundreds of thousands of people, like EDC and stuff like that, it's more about the experience than it is the talent of the DJ. Because a lot of those DJs aren't DJs. So the best they can do is put on auto mix and let it go and throw their hands up in the air and pump the crowd up. That's all they can really do. But I mean, you know, the fact that they get paid hundreds of thousands of dollars to do that is a bit disconcerting.
Like a lot of these guys were producers or engineers in the studio doing the work for all other DJs. So they said, why the hell should I make 50 grand a year in a studio doing somebody's edits? I can make 50 grand a night being a DJ myself.
Yeah, exactly. But you know what? Right before we went into the pandemic, the Vegas clubs and festivals or whatever out here had come basically to a pact with all of the different organizations that were doing them that they were no longer going to pay DJs that kind of money. Because I'm a DJ, and don't get me wrong, you offer me 50 grand, I'm taking it. But at the end of the day, I remember, you know, and I'm sure you remember this as well. Back in the day, when we first started, we were in a closet somewhere, nobody cared about us. You know, you played records from 9 o'clock in the morning till 4 or 5 straight, and you got $25 if you were lucky. So for me, you know, $2,500 is great. I'll take $25,000 or $50,000, but my point is that I would do it because I loved it. It wasn't about the money back then.
Well, like in the 80s, I was the first one in Buffalo to break $150 a night. I was a rock star because a nice new car was like 10 grand. You could buy one of the cash, like, you know, and no time.
How much did you make on your first gig, Jay?
Oh, I had to play for free. There was no money.
How about the marshmallow deal? Oh my god,
man! In the clubs in Australia, you're getting paid less now than you were getting paid 10 years ago. That's a sad thing. I was going to say I interviewed David Morales a couple of weeks ago, and we were chatting about how when he started DJing, even though he's a superstar now and he gets paid all over the world. When he first started DJing, like you said, Charlie, you were stuck in the corner. It wasn't about the DJ. You were sight unseen. You just played the music that everybody got to hear, and through hard work and determination, he's got where he has today. But he said for 10 years, the DJ was nowhere. When he first started off, he came from Brooklyn. He played his sets. And then funny enough, we DJed Detroit Swindle, which are a very big group now these days in production and songwriting and DJing, great performance guys. And they told me, and we agreed, is that the best feeling a DJ can have is playing music to a public that they didn't know they liked, and to see in the reaction for music they weren't expecting to hear. So when you get those pre-recorded sets, you don't get that opportunity. Or when you're playing to a light show in a festival, you have to hit certain markers, so you can't do that. So playing those gigs where you can take people on a different path and show them music that they never ever heard before, that's the skill of a good DJ.
My boss, one of the top promoters I worked for, he told me a few years ago, he goes, you were the best DJ I ever had because you knew how to take him there. And I would just have a smile on my face as I went into another record and watched the reaction. I was like,
One of my favorite things when I'm playing, especially when you're playing for like a big crowd. I remember I was playing this one rave in Germany called Nature One. It was about 125,000 people, right? So here you have this massive crowd in front of you. And every little thing I do, that if I was in a club, an intimate club, they wouldn't probably make much difference and nobody would move. But every little thing I did, whether it was with the bass control or a volume control, made the crowd move one way or another. So it got to be like I was a puppet master. I could just make them go this way or go that way. And I was like, wow, this is an experience.
Like when we did the first We did the Woodstock of Disco in Buffalo in 1979. Over 15,000 people showed up for what was called the world's largest disco. And there I am, we're playing in between there. Me, Bobby DJ Gunadaro for the Studio 54, Michael Lewis from the Studio 1 in LA, Wally McDonald from Toronto, John Siglia from New York. And there we are playing for 15,000 people in the Buffalo Convention Center. I mean, what a rush that was. And we played in between each band, the Tramps, Gloria Gaynor, Edwin Starr, Fern Kitty, Cindy and Roy. It was unbelievable. And 25 years ago, a promoter wanted to do a disco party, and I said, why don't we do the World's Largest Disco 15-year reunion? And it's been a festival every Thanksgiving Saturday in Buffalo now ever since. It sells out in 3 days, 8,000 tickets. And these are young kids whose parents, I probably dated their mother, back in the disco, 40 years ago, or I went out with their grandmother.
and grandma.
Easy, Tiger, easy.
And these girls are 21 years old. So, they're all dressed disco clothes, and their parents, I said to this girl, she had all her top bell bottoms on. I said, where'd you get that? She goes, my mother found them in the attic. And that's a true story. But every year it sells out, the world's largest disco. And Bobby Gunadaro coined it Woodstock of Disco back in 1979.
Nice. Can I ask you, Charlie, a personal question? How did you feel when they did the disco demolition thing
I was hoping you'd ask that. Well, you know what? People who hated disco were people that couldn't dance. I always said that.
Exactly.
And if you didn't dance, you didn't get the girl. So that pissed them off even more. And I thought it was kind of sad. But you know, at the time, record label, the major labels jumped on it. You know, disco was founded by labels like TK Records, like Ray Caviano's RFC, Prelude Records, Marvin Tucker's label. And all these Roulette Records, you know. And then by the end of the 70s, Atlantic and all the major labels, Capitol, just started signing crap and passing it off as disco. Like Ethel Merman, who was a disco version of There's No Business Like Show Business. Who the hell wanted to hear that? They're discoing up everything. Like if you saw that World's Largest, or the When Disco Ruled the World thing on VH1, I was involved in. It's on YouTube. But they're discoing up everything. Burger King ads. Let's disco to Burger King. But that's what happened. And record labels said, "Oh shit!" What a good story. Henry Stone, dear old friend Henry Stone from TK Records. He's one of the original record men for the 50s. He was about to sell TK Records to Columbia for a couple million dollars, I guess. And hours away from signing, the powers that be said, this disco stuff's dead. They just had this disco demolition thing. And the deal fell through. Henry Stone lost his revolving line of credit. And that's the true story. And Henry Stone, that's what happened to TK and all those great labels he had, Alston Records, Drive Records, all that. Yeah, that's a true story.
Wow.
He was this far away from signing the deal.
I've been there. Many times with deals where, for me, I had a couple of artists that probably some of the most talented artists I've ever worked with in my life, singers, but one in particular was like so ghetto. When I say ghetto, I mean, she was the ghettoest of ghetto, where she walked around with a fifth in her hand, all the time.
That's a good promotion.
I mean, this girl was so talented, right? And I got a deal for her over at Universal. Incredible deal, right? This was kind of like when I had really established myself as a producer and everything. And so they were willing to give me pretty much whatever I wanted. I got this girl a $500,000 deal, which was unheard of for a new artist, right? Wow. Matter of fact, Natalie Cole's husband was signing her. He was actually head of A&R at the time. And then Ernie Singleton, who's actually a mentor of mine, was actually president of the label. But I walked over there. They loved the demos. We were just about to do the contract. She picks up the phone after I told her that we got a deal, calls over there and says, oh, I'm glad you guys are signing me. Like, you know, basically you should be signing me because I'm, you know, the shit, so to say, or whatever. And, you know, you should recognize it. And then she goes, why can't you just sign me directly? What do we need Jesse for?
That's
all I get is from the business affairs department saying, well, that deal we just had on the table, it's gone. You need to learn how to control your heart.
Wow.
Oh man, I was so mad. I said, you know what? I'm just not going to do that again. I'm going to do what Motown did back in the day. I am going to send you through artist development, teach you how to talk to people, when to talk, how to interview, and do the whole nine yards. That will never happen to me again. But unfortunately, it did a couple more years later with another artist.
what's good that happened, though, in late 1980, disco snuck in the back door again. But George Benson, Give Me the Night, Prince, Rick James, all the girl groups. And that's what Brady and Scalzo really got strong with, Sky, with Aura, with they had Prelude just had a lot of Unlimited Touch and all those groups, Sharon Red. And the soulful version of disco came back into the mainstream again in the 80s.
All right.
As someone who has been grown up in a generation where the DJ was always the main focus and always kind of who you went to go see, Jesse, for you, can you pinpoint when that kind of changed? Because, you know, when you guys were doing it, like you said, DJs were in the closet, they thought about, but now it's kind of, they're the main act. How did that change?
I remember exactly when it happened. I did a tour. I came over to your neck of the woods across the pond, JB. I did a tour over in London in 1986. Love Can't Turn Around had just hit the top of the pops. And
that's right.
Because of that, they organized the tour for it. We did 30 dates in 29 days. So that was enough in itself. But wow. One day I was DJing at the Virgin Megastore, and I look up and I see a video with Daryl Pandy singing Love Can't Turn Around. Now, I had no idea that there was a video. As a matter of fact, Farley had only informed me maybe a month or two before that London Records had even signed the single and was going to release it. And I was in LA, so I, you know, when I left Chicago, I had no ties, really. I was going to say something else, but I really kind of cut my ties because my life at that point was in LA, you know. In those days, because the DJ wasn't such a big thing, I felt as a producer, I was bigger and better, so to say. You know, I graduated. I was a DJ, now I've become a producer and an artist, more money, bigger things, you know, just everything. So that's where my head was. So when I saw that on TV, I just thought to myself, this is the most amazing thing I've ever seen in my life. Next thing I know, as soon as we get done with that tour, I'm called not maybe less than a month later to come back, and they're willing to pay me $3,000. My flights put me up in hotels, 4-star everything, 5-star this and that. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, huh? You know, because the last time I got paid to do a DJ gig, I was doing what you made, Charlie. I got $150. You know? So I'm thinking to myself, this must be a mistake and somebody's playing a joke on me, right?
And we were rock stars too for $150.
Then I talked to some of my friends, some of my peers that were putting out records on DJ International and Tracks at the time, and they said, yeah, we did a tour over there not too long ago where they paid us, you know, X amount of dollars. And I'm just thinking, like, when did all this change? They said, right now. He's like, go get it while you can. So that's what started that trek. Everybody going over there and playing from Chicago.
The big turning point for us was when NME, newspaper or musical magazine in the UK, went to Chicago and really did shine a light on Chicago House. And then we had tours that had you, obviously, that came over. We also had ones involved Marshall Jefferson. I remember very distinctly at the age of 20 watching Daryl Pandy on Top of the Pops, which is a national television program in the UK where Love Can't Turn Around was on. He kicked his shoe off into the crowd. And it was great, but with house music in the UK especially, we only had one
national radio program and a couple of other FM licenses. They weren't really that prevalent. So the only way we could get access to house music was either through illegal raves or illegal pirate radio. And Kiss FM and Solar and a lot of other pirate radio stations. I remember driving around London trying to catch the signal so that I could listen to the new music, because you couldn't get it anywhere else. You could not find it. So there's all these guys like Danny Rampling and all the other people that started off DJing in the UK would broadcast on these pirate radio stations. Norman Jay, you'd have to go and see him on a Monday night in South London. It was just really, really hard to get to find this music, and therefore it became a community, just like it is now. And then,
hey, do you remember Quark Pirate Radio? Quark Radio?
No.
You don't remember that one?
Well, no, they're back. I was in London.
Why I say that?
The Kiss was the one for me, because that was the one I could get reception on, because they'd be broadcasting from a tower block somewhere. And then all of a sudden the police would raid it, they'd have to move.
Right.
But yeah, no, that was how we got our early missing. And John Peel used to play a little bit on BBC Radio 1, but there was never the exposure. Like you got with your radio, with Hot Mix 5 in Chicago. We didn't have anything like that in London. So it was very subversive and underground.
And I want to take this moment, because we've got Chicago, New York, and London in your start of career, Australia now. So, Charlie, I'm going to go to you first. But we all know New Yorkers like to put their own stamp on things. So what are some key pieces that go into a New York-specific house track?
A New York-specific house track, I think, is a lot of female vocals. Female vocals are always big in the disco records and the soulful records back in the 70s. And I think New York and some good male vocals too. Colonel Abrams was one of my favorite, and Luther Vandross sang with Change. Rick Avion gave his first big break. He went solo, a good thumping groovy beat, and some good strong soulful vocals, male or female. But it's no sampling, just a song, you know. A song with a hook, a song with a really good hook.
How about for Chicago, Jesse?
The whole reason why Chicago House became Chicago House had absolutely nothing to do with anybody singing. It had nothing to do with a melody or a song. It was all about booty shaking music. So all we wanted to do was make that bass hit hard. And so people could jack. That's where the whole jack your body thing came from, because people would grab the trees, the table, the speakers, you name it. And when that hard beat came in, beating you over your head, it just made everybody go wild. So that's what Chicago was known for.
My goodness. All right. And across the pond, what are some staples of the music over there, Jay?
Well, personally, the UK might be so diverse, and house music exists in so many different forms in the UK. I don't think you could even begin to define it by one particular notion of a house track. All I can say is that house music should move you from the hips and from the heart and from the soul. And if it does that, it's house.
Yeah, I think the evolution of house transitioned more towards the disco sound. That's why you even have like a category now that's called disco house. But yeah, even the soulful house is all disco based. It's all based on that four on the floor, rhythmic, grooving, soulful vocals, choir-esque type vocals like gospel, so on and so forth. That's what house has come back to be worldwide.
On the XM54, the Studio 54 channel on XM Satellite Radio, they have a new disco hour now, and great stuff. It's like new house meets old disco. And there's a lot of good tracks coming out. The Purple Disco Machine, Berkman, all these guys. There's so many good, a lot of new stuff coming out. I mean, it's like fabulous. I mean, I can't get enough of that new disco hour. And I get my phone in my car and I take a picture of every song that's playing on there. You know, and I go online trying to find it. I say, oh, shit, I like this. Let me see.
Get out your Shazam. Yeah. You need to get Shazam.
Yeah, I know. I'm old school. I'm lucky I could turn this phone on for this interview today.
But the thing with disco as well. I was going to say, the thing with disco as well, the way it changed its development, because disco became so expensive for people to record, because you need a full band and full arrangement and everything like that, which is why Jesse's On and On became so revolutionary. And then now everybody produces everything in the box, and they're able to sample and edit and loop and things like that. So you're getting people going back and absolutely mining the huge back catalogues of people like Sal Soul, Philly Soul, all of this, and they're taking excerpts out and they're reimagining those tracks and providing great
things. Yes, they are.
And I think all credit to them, because those songs deserve to have some light shone on them.
Oh, I would get a lot of young DJs coming up to me here in Vegas when I first moved here. They'd be playing a song. Charlie, what's the sample from? I want to hear the actual song of the sample from. You know, so they want to hear where it came from, you know? And one thing about the 70s is that there wasn't any sampling because everybody wrote their own music. You know, they wrote and produced their own music. You know, Gamble and Huff, Baker Harris, Young, Bunny Sigler, Vince Montana. These are all great arrangers. They have great songwriters. But again, to go perform live, you would need two tour buses just for the band members.
Exactly.
And, you know, it's just that. That's why I was talking to Brian Setzer, and he says, when he was here in Vegas, and he said he doesn't do the Brian Setzer Orchestra anymore. He goes, I was real big in Japan, but you know what it costs to fly 40 people over there? You know, it's a new world, but thanks to technology, you can bring those people with you.
So what kind of encouragement do you guys have for new buddies? Days that are just now getting into the house scene? We'll start with you, Jay.
For me, you got to find your own sound. You got to be yourself. Stop trying to be someone else. Don't try and mimic anybody else. Find your own way. And find something that you truly love. Don't play a genre just because it's popular with other people. Play a genre that you love, because when you love something, that shines through. Learn to build anticipation and just be dedicated to what you do. I've never been a standout DJ. I've had other things in my life that have meant that I couldn't follow the DJ path, if you know what I mean. Like, I just love playing music, and when I get the opportunity these days, I play. And if you're going into the DJ world to become famous, to get your position in life, you're going to treat it like a business and a money earner, and that's your singular focus from day one, I think that detracts to what you're able to show people, and it becomes very one-dimensional. I think if you demonstrate that you truly love what you're doing and not just showing off behind a DJ console throwing love hearts and cake and things like this, just being a DJ, and let's face it, a DJ is there to entertain the crowd through music, not through them being at the center of the story. So if you're allowed to take people along and give them something passionate that they can believe in, I think that that's what really does make a good DJ. Dedication, and don't worry if you get knocked back. Everybody has failures. Just because you have one failure doesn't mean you throw it away. Have many failures, because what we learn is that if you have a failure and you move on and you go stronger from that, you become a better person.
Hey, go ahead and plug your radio show, which is amazing. We actually come on back-to-back on Bondi Radio out of Australia. He does a two-hour segment that's, I mean, like a regular announcer. I consider myself a pseudo announcer, but I prefer to let the artists speak for themselves, so I kind of, you know, let them do all the plugs and the introductions. But my show is on 11 a.m., but if you're in the States, it's 17 hours ahead, so it's actually on Sunday, but over here it comes on at 6 p.m. on Saturday, and Jay's right after me at 7 for 2 hours, and he plays some amazing stuff. Go ahead, and I already plugged you, but go ahead and give yourself a plug.
Yeah, thanks, man. So, as part of the magazine, we started doing this radio program as well on a Sunday, which is 2 hours. And we try not to just be a mix show. If we wanted to be a mix show, people may as well play Spotify or something like that. And we've only been going with this particular program for 2 months, but we started to bring in
special interviews, designated hour specials. This week, we've got an hour special dedicated to Byron Stingley, and we've got some interviews that we conducted with him over the week, so we're really pleased with that. And the radio show is really supposed to be about giving a showcase for DJs. We give them a 30-minute mix so that they can lay down what they want, and then we try and be an informative and let people know as much as going on as we possibly can without detracting too much from the music. But it's been very enjoyable, hopefully, as the months progress, we'll draw a bigger and bigger audience until house music takes over the world. Yeah.
Yeah.
And Charlie, did you want to wrap up with any advice for young DJs?
Yeah, I agree with Jay. You know, if you're going to make it your passion, you know, do what you really believe in. Play what you really believe in. Take chances playing for a crowd. Like in the old days, I was lucky enough where the club owners gave me free rein. And when I played something cool and unique and different, my club owner would run up to the sound booth screaming, turn it up, because there were club owners back then that knew music, you know, which is, you don't see too much these days. And I had a club owner, man, what's that tune you play? Man, what's that jam? Play it again later in the night, you know? And, if you have to play a formatted music format, you know, in a club or wherever you're going to play, it's not going to be much fun. Dare to be different and give them those few little treats during the night that are going to make them jump out of their shoes, something old, out of the ordinary. Yes. You know, instead of just playing all the current stuff, like I would always play a song from like 20 years ago and the kids would go, woo, like, wow, it's just those little treats, you know. But don't get stuck in a stagnant music format. Do what you believe, enjoy it. Otherwise, you're not going to have any fun doing it. Yeah. And it just becomes, I'm going to get paid. I'm making all this money. Here I am, 25-year-old DJ, working at the Palms. I'm driving a Lamborghini. Shit. I drove a Fiat when I was. Do it. If you really love it, you know, embrace it and don't get pushed around by other people's emotions. Just do what you feel is right and let the music flow. Let the music spread the love and dare to be different.
Yeah, I agree. And advice I can give people, if they don't like doing the 1 hour set, and I think the 1 hour set is what has killed a lot of nightclubs because they can't build up continuity of content. If you don't like doing the 1 hour set and you don't like doing the club thing, start your own thing. Start your own thing. Be brave, make choices, and deliver what you want to do. I know there may be a certain financial aspect to that which prevents you, but there's always a solution. If you don't like what's being done and you think you have something to offer, do your own thing.
Awesome, guys.
Definitely. Exactly. Well, thank you, guys. This has been a pleasure. We're here with two of the featured stories from my book, In Their Own Words. It's available on Amazon. Please go out and support. And if you'd like your copy autographed, you can hit me up and I'll tell you how to do that. Thank you to my lovely co-host, Jesse,
I'll hit Dave. You over the coffee bean.
I know. I'll see you over at Coffee Bean. I actually get it over there after I get done with this.
You know, okay.
and Jay, as always, we will talk or chat on Messenger. Mm-hmm. You know, it was interesting the other day when we actually like tested the Zoom. And I'm just like, oh my God, we're actually talking to each other instead of like messaging each other, because we message back and forth almost every day, and it's a very interesting way to keep in touch. But the beauty of it, obviously, is that I can communicate with anybody anywhere in the world at the drop of a dime, and that's what's brought all of this together. And kind of made me want to bring these stories together, because now I've been able to experience all of these different stories from people who may be different because they're from a different country, but they're the same as us because they love house music. So thank you guys once again for coming on. And I'm sure sometime in the future, we'll probably have you back.
And nice meeting all of you too, by the way.
Tomorrow we will have on Jay Infexis, who is also known as Jonathan Weissnith. He is a promoter from San Diego. He's the first guy to bring me down there, which turned into be one of my favorite places to play. And we also have Chicago's very own, Lil John Coleman. You all know him, you love him. It's my boy. We had about a 3-hour conversation the other day. It's probably the first time we talked like that in 20 years, but it's going to be some amazing, amazing stories from them as well. And once again, thank you all for tuning in, and we'll be here tomorrow night, same time, 8 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Where am I? Oh, Pacific. And it's 2 a.m. in London, and what is it, 11 a.m. on the next day for you, Jay?
Yeah, 2 days from now.
I'm getting the hang of this thing here.
We're in the future.
It's Monday morning, and I'll say
Saturday morning.
It's Saturday morning. Don't these time zones, man. I'm getting jet lagged digitally now instead of flying. All right. So we will see you same time, same station tomorrow. Thank you guys once again.
See ya.
See ya, man. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
And so.
See you later, Jeff.